Welcome, future nurses. So today I'm going to talk about the nursing process. So very similar to Maslow's, you use your nursing process with every client encounter. It will be a part of every test question. So if you haven't already reviewed my Maslow's video, please do so on my YouTube page. But I'm going to quickly go through the nursing process. I have a scenario we're going to walk through so you know how to apply the nursing process. And then at the end, we'll do one question. Okay? So when you think about the nursing process, I want you to think about this is how we systematically look at clients. So the first step is assessment. So before we can do any action or intervention step of our nursing process, you have to have collected data to see if we even have a problem. So always think in my nursing process, it's a systematic process and I will go in order. When you answer test questions, whenever you see those words, what do you do first? All four good answers. We'll look back at your scenario. Do you have any assessment data at all on this client? If you don't, that should automatically be a hint that I need to go and assess my client first. Please also review the NCLEX style test question breakdown video that I have posted as well, and Maslow's The Nursing Process and thinking about how to break down questions together. I hope will make you more successful on your test in nursing school. So nursing process, we always say ADPI because your steps of the nursing process are assessment, diagnosis, planning, intervention, and evaluation. So let's start with assessment. When you think about assessment, I want you to think about the collection of data, okay? Anything that we do that just gathers information on our client. However, the assessment step will never change client outcomes. So I'll give you an example. When we get labs on a client, even though we are physically inserting a needle into their skin, it doesn't help them. It doesn't change their outcome. The purpose of gathering labs is only to collect data. So when you're thinking about assessment, I want you to think collection of information, collection of data. So I've listed a couple examples. When you gather vital signs, all you're doing is collecting data. Labs, health history, when you are asking them all of those questions, do you have allergies? Do you have any history of other diseases? That is just gathering information. Your physical assessment, what we physically assess on a client as a nurse, our head to toe. It includes inspection. When you walk into that room, we can inspect and see if their respiratory rate has changed, if their breathing is labored. So think about all your assessment techniques, inspection, auscultation, palpation, and percussion, and that is also just a part of assessing, of gathering data. So I do want to point out, you should be aware of objective versus subjective data. Objective data is data that you can verify. We can prove that this data is factual. Vital signs, we can verify that those vital signs are correct. Laboratory tests, we can verify that those labs are correct. So objective data, we can prove, we can see. Subjective data, we cannot prove. So when you think about subjective data, two very common subjective topics that are constantly occurring in healthcare is pain and nausea. So if a client states they have pain 10 out of 10 and they are on social media, we have to take that pain account as being true because we cannot jump into their body and understand how they're feeling pain. So pain is subjective. If we as nurses were to wait until that pain became objective, for instance, it's shown on vital signs. If we're in excruciating pain, our heart rate would pop up, our blood pressure would pop up. That's not ethical. So pain is subjective data that we take as is. Whatever the client states is what the pain level is. Nausea. We can't prove nausea. If a client says that they're nauseous, there's no way we can prove it. But we take that subjective data as is. Anything that the patient states is subjective, or a family member states. A client comes into the ED, I had a temperature of 101.5 at home. That is subjective data. We can't prove that that client's temperature was 101.5 at home. We would have to gather our own objective data and get our own temperature. You would never give acetaminophen or Tylenol to a client who says says that their temperature is 101.5 at home without proving it first. So subjective data, anything we can't prove, if you ever see quotation marks in scenarios, NCLEX style scenarios, patient statements, family statements, all subjective data that we'd want to continue to gather our own information on. Again, remember, pain and nausea are examples of subjective data that we can act on because we have no other way of verifying it. So that's an example of your assessment, think gathering data. Once we gather our data, the purpose of gathering data is to determine, do our clients have right here, right now problems, or do they have potential problems that may occur? So we're trying to see a whole picture, and then we're trying to focus in on problems that they might have or potential problems. This is called diagnosis. So your diagnosis is always based upon your assessment. So we've gathered all this data, and now we're trying to see if there's any problems. So diagnosis, as nurses, we don't medically diagnose. We are thinking nursing diagnosis. So always refer back to your NANDA diagnosis list. They're online. I'm sure your instructor could provide them to you. But we create nursing diagnosis. So I want you to understand it's two-part versus three-part. And as nurses, we like to focus on the priority problem. So when we do our scenario, I'm actually going to show you an example of how to write a diagnosis. So once we determine or figure out if there's a problem or a potential problem, we need to start planning. Planning is we have figured out they have a problem, or we have figured out they're at risk for a problem, and we're going to develop a plan to ensure that this client has the best outcomes in our care. So when you think about planning, I want you to think about goal development. In goal development, we like to say our goals should always be SMART, which stands for specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and timely. So I'll also give you an example of goal in just one second when we do our scenario. So we developed a plan for our client, and now we're going to implement this plan. So with your interventions or implementation, I want you to think that these actions will change a client's outcome. So let's say I assessed and my client's pulse oximetry was 72%. We know that's not normal. So we are diagnosing that they have a right here, right now problem, impaired oxygenation or impaired tissue perfusion. So we're going to develop a plan or identify a goal that we want them to meet, and then we're going to act. So our action for our client's pulse ox is 72% is to put them on oxygen or sit the head of the bed up, cough, deep breathe. So interventions or implementation, I want you to think these things will change clients' outcomes. Giving oxygen, giving fluids, administering blood products, sitting the head of the bed up, turning clients. These are all actions that will change the client's outcome. So that is what we are talking about when we're talking about interventions. And the last thing is evaluation. So once we figured out there was a problem or a potential problem, we acted or intervened on this client, and we always have to evaluate, did our actions work? If that client's pulse ox was 72% and we put them on oxygen, our evaluation would be to reassess that pulse ox to ensure that the actions that we took as a nurse worked. And we'd want to see that pulse oximeter level back above 90%, okay? And I'm a big proponent of applying. It's important to understand your nursing process, but once you start applying it to scenarios, you can see how it works. So I did a little scenario for you, and I'm going to walk you through your entire steps of your nursing process. So a two-day post-operative cholecystectomy client. That means they got their gallbladder out 2 days ago. Let's look at all our information. The client has complaints of abdominal pain 10 out of 10. Client is nauseous. These are the vital signs, laboratory data. So let's start breaking down these vital signs. Elevated temperature. So we're thinking risk of infection. They have elevated respiratory rate, they're tachypneic. Heart rate is high, blood pressure is low. So now there might be a circulation problem going on. Our labs are showing elevated white blood cells, so potential infection. Now we're looking at hemoglobin, hematocrit, which are low levels. Your physical assessment shows purulent drainage from the incision, so we're thinking infection. Firm, rigid abdomen. We like soft, flat abdomens or soft, rounded abdomens. This is not normal. Their heart rhythm is regular, lungs are clear upon auscultation, their skin is warm and diaphoretic, and they are now confused. So a lot of information going on. So let's start with our assessment process. So we have a lot of assessment data, but now we need to start digging into it because we always want to focus on priorities. As a nurse, we address mind, body, and spirit. But remember, in the NCLEX testing world, the NCLEX is just trying to see, can you identify priorities? Will you keep that client safe? So with all this information, we are going to figure out what is the one thing that if we focus on, this will kill the client first, okay? So let's first break apart objective versus subjective data. Client complains of abdominal pain. So pain is always subjective. Actually, I'm going to write in a blue marker. If you're a visual learner, color coding is wonderful. So pain, subjective. Nausea, subjective. Our vital signs are all objective. Laboratory work is all objective. And your physical assessment is all objective. You gather this information so you can verify that it was accurate upon gathering. So all objective information. And now we're looking at all this assessment information and we want to get to our diagnosis. We want to determine right here, right now problems. And typically, if you can only focus on one thing, you would always focus on the priority. So let's identify our topics. We have pain, we have nausea, we have temperatures with the laboratory work and the purulent drainage from our infection, I'm sorry, from our incision, we can start thinking infection. So this is infection, infection, infection. Respiratory rate alone can't really show us a problem, but let's look. High heart rate, low blood pressure, low hemoglobin and hematocrit. That is showing us a right here, right now circulation problem. They could be bleeding. We don't really know exactly what's going on, but we do know there's a circulation problem. Our blood pressure is low, and our heart is trying to cope by pumping faster to circulate more volume in our body because we know that fluid transports oxygen to our tissues. So I'm thinking circulation, 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 firm, rigid abdomen. Again, something is going on with the GI tract. Could be related to the incision site, could be related to motility. But now we're thinking abnormal GI problem. This all looks good. Normal heart rhythm, normal lung sound, skin is warm and diaphoretic. Our client should not just be sweating. That's not normal. So with all the data going on, I would think it's related to the infection, so we can group it in there. And then confusion. This is a clear D. When I say Maslow's airway, breathing, circulation, D, decreased level of consciousness, but I want you to think about it as a change in behavior. Confusion is never normal. So we would have to figure out why they are confused. So as an instructor, I'd like for my students to look at all the problems. But a lot of times we don't have them map out all the different diagnoses. Some instructors could. I want you to focus on the priority. So when we're looking at all this information, if they're gonna die from something right here, right now, it's gonna be related to this fluid volume deficit. They are losing blood, or they are losing fluid, they're losing volume from their body, and we're going to have to act quickly and to try to help them. So let's talk about our diagnosis. You have two-part versus three-part diagnosis. If you have a right here, right now problem, it has to be three parts. So right now, we have a right here, right now circulatory problem, and it's not fluid volume overload, it's related to fluid volume deficit. So if you look at your NANDA diagnosis, you have a lot of diagnosis, but the one I'm going to just give you an example of is fluid volume deficit. So fluid volume deficit. And when I say three-part, we always say related to. So R/G, related to what? Well, what did this client have done that could have put them at risk for fluid volume deficit? They just had surgery 2 days ago. They could... lot of potentials after surgery, risk of dehydration, risk of hemorrhage. So all we know is that this is a surgical client, and if they're losing volume, most likely it's related to that surgery. So related to surgery, and if it's a right here, right now problem, you have to say as evidenced by. So as evidenced by, and please be careful about abbreviations. write it all out if your instructor prefers, and let's see what evidence, what assessment data proves that they have a fluid volume deficit problem. Tachycardia, hypotension, and low hemoglobin and hematocrit. Hemoglobin and hematocrit. So this is what I mean by three parts. Your actual diagnosis, which is right here, right now. They're having a right here, right now circulatory problem related to them being a postoperative client or having recent surgery as evidenced by. This is the data that supports my nursing diagnosis. So we can also have a two part. I'm going to erase this just because of the limited room on my board. And my two-part diagnosis are if we have potential problems. So they're not right here, right now, but we know they can potentially occur, so they're a risk up. So anytime we think about a confused client, there it automatically falls into a risk of falls. So if it's a risk up, it's not happening right here, right now, but we as nurses better prevent it from happening. So the diagnosis, the potential diagnosis I'm going to use is risk of falls, and it's only going to be two parts. What is your risk of falls related to? Well, for this client, the risk of falls is related to they are now confused, related to confusion. And we can't put as evidenced by, because as evidenced by means that this diagnosis occurred. If the client fell, that would be evidence that this is now a right here, right now problem. So it would not fall under the category of potential or risk of. So this is an example of a two-part diagnosis. Risk of falls related to confusion. And now we're gonna start thinking about our goals. So just remember my first diagnosis, fluid volume deficit related to surgery as evidenced by tachycardia, hypotension, and low hemoglobin hematocrit. We know they're losing volume. Okay, we can't prove exactly where from, but we know they're losing volume. So let's develop a goal. So goals need to be specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and timely. So a big thing for students, because when I see my students develop their care plans, is the measurable part they really need to learn about. So I have a problem with fluid volume deficit. As a nurse, what goal can I create to ensure that I'm monitoring this problem appropriately? So, one of the easiest ways to assess circulation, especially related to fluid volume deficit, is blood pressure. So, I'm going to monitor the blood pressures and create a goal that I want to see my client reach in hopes that they are having a better outcome. So, the client will maintain a systolic blood pressure greater than 100 millimeters of mercury my entire shift. So this is just a very basic goal. Let's see if we've met all of our criteria. Is it specific? It's very specific. I'm letting people know that I'm going to look at the blood pressure to see if I'm reaching my goal. Is it measurable? We can take the blood pressure. I should be constantly monitoring this client's vital signs, and I should be able to see if I am reaching my goal or not. If the systolic is less than 100, we are not reaching the goal that we want to reach. Attainable. Our client's blood pressure should be able to get greater than 100 systolically if we are doing appropriate interventions. It's realistic and it's timely. I have put a time frame to it, meaning my entire shift. In my 8-hour shift, if I'm working this 8 hours with this client, while I'm monitoring the blood pressure through the shift, I should ensure that my goal of getting a systolic blood pressure greater than 100 millimeters of mercury is being met. So it's meeting all of the criteria of a SMART goal. And now we would think about interventions. Remember, interventions are actions that would help this client. So we have a problem with fluid volume deficit. What can we do to help them? We can give fluids. We can give blood products. We can give medication to cause vasoconstriction that could improve blood pressure in the client's body. So when you are thinking about your interventions or your implementation phase, these need to be actions. And my problem is fluid volume deficit, so I'm going to do actions that help fluid volume deficit. And then your evaluation, did my interventions work? Let's say I listed the three interventions: administer fluids, administer blood products, administer a vasoconstrictor. So I've done these interventions, and my evaluation would be to see if these interventions would work. So I would go back in that room and assess the client's blood pressure to ensure that it is increasing. Or let's say my goal said the client's hemoglobin will be greater than 9 grams per deciliter by the end of my shift or within 2 days. That's a measurable goal. And if we're administering blood products, our evaluation would be to redraw our complete blood count, our CBC, to see if our hemoglobin and hematocrit increased. So this is just an example of applying your nursing process. Always take your instructor's resources and make sure to tailor it to what they are teaching you. But I just hope this helps you to better understand it. So one last thing, let's do a quick question so we can tie it all together. So the nurse is caring for a client diagnosed with hypertension on 25 milligrams of metoprolol PO/BID. So they're going to get a beta blocker twice a day. Identify the following steps of the nursing process and place them in order of priority. Okay? So let's just read them and see what phase of the nursing process it is. Hold the dose of metoprolol. Okay? Is this assessment? No, we are gathering no data. Is this diagnosis? Are we identifying a problem? No, there's no information that we're identifying a problem. Are we doing an action that will change a client's outcome? If you hold a dose of a medication, will it change the client's outcome? Yes. This is a beta blocker. If we hold the dose of the beta blocker, you should see their heart rate come up. At least you should not see a drop in their heart rate. So this is an example of the intervention phase. Intervention. Let's see. Reassess apical pulse. Reassess is a big key word. We are not assessing. It is not the initial assessment. It says reassess, meaning we have done an action, and now we are trying to see if that action has worked or not worked. So when I see a reassess, off gate in my brain, I should be thinking evaluation. Okay, so reassessment, we are trying to verify if an action worked. So this is an example of the evaluation phase. And let's see, last one. Apical pulse auscultated at 52 beats per minute. You assess the apical pulse and you determine that it was 52 beats per minute. This does not change their outcome. The only example this is a collection of data. So this is an example of the assessment phase of our nursing process. And if we have to put them in order, we always think ad pie. So assessment is first, so it'd be C, and then intervention would be next in our nursing process. And then last, we would evaluate to see if that intervention worked. So B. So the nurse assessed an apical pulse less than 60 in her assessment, her initial assessment data. She determined that she had to act by holding the medication, and she would want to evaluate if holding the medication improved that heart rate by reassessing the apical pulse. And I say she a lot, but male nurses, I know you're out there doing your own thing. So he or she, forgive me for that, the nurse. Should I say? So, I hope this helped you all understand your nursing process better. As always, we are better together, so help one another, nursing students. If this helped you and you can help somebody else, please share the information. Have a great day.